winds down, but it's an important meeting, and I wanted to get it started as promptly as possible. I certainly, on behalf of the City Council, want to thank the school board for agreeing to meet with us today. I know we have a lot of serious matters to talk about. I would like this to be a really free-ranging, full discussion about the status of our schools. I know you have an agenda here, and we'll follow that as closely as we can, but without any more of a wind-up and having thanked you for coming, maybe I'll just let the chairman begin with the first agenda item, which has to do with the SOL results.
Thank you, Mayor Frame, council members, city manager, Mr. Jones, and Dr. King and board members, good afternoon. We appreciate the opportunity to have this conversation with you all this afternoon, and of course, the matter that is of greatest importance to all of us is the current status of our schools, the accreditation of our schools, and more specifically, the most recent SOL results. We have put a lot of time in the last 2 months reviewing the results and also discussing, identifying the root causes, and also discussing the plan for going forward. We feel it important today to, even though we emailed the information to the mayor and council regarding the scores and the preview or projected accreditation, of course, none of this is final as of yet until next month. But we did provide you last week with the information relative to the performance of all of our schools. And today, what we want to do is provide you with an overview of the results, as well as our the current proposal that the superintendent is working on, commonly referred to as the Transformation Initiative, and the 5-year strategic plan that the board embraced and adopted in our summer retreat. We realize we have a limited amount of time, and we never have enough time, of course, to discuss all these issues, and we want to make sure that we provide adequate time for questions and answers and discussion. And so I've asked the superintendent to provide a brief overview of all three of those areas, and you have the PowerPoint presentations before you, and then to ensure that we have time to get into these. Now, of course, if there are questions that you have while Dr. King is presenting, so we'll certainly stop and entertain those questions. But the plan was to give a brief overview of each of these areas and then entertain any questions or concerns that you all have. Okay. Dr. King?
Okay, thank you, Mayor Frank, members of council, Chairman Houston, members of the board, as well as guests. It is truly a significant opportunity for us to come before you to talk about current status and in reference to where we are, also implications for planning moving forward. I would like to provide a pretty concise yet complete, although brief, synopsis so that it gives us the details in terms of what are the opportunities for improvement, what are the implications around that, as well as what are the positives that we experience throughout the whole process. So I will begin with the accreditation benchmark piece, which you have before you. Of course, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because this gives all involved a quick picture, a quick view of expectations at the state level as far as benchmarking. Elementary grades 3, of course, is an accountable grade, as well as grade 4 and 5. Middle school grades 6 through 8. Also high school grades 9 through 12. You see a 2-year view of the benchmarks. Again, these are the benchmark expectations from the state in terms of the percentage of students that would be anticipated to meet and or exceed standards. In red, you will see that certain figures are circled. That is to draw your attention to any changes in benchmarks from the previous year to this year. So if that was ramped up at all, the circles would indicate and reflect that. The areas that are highlighted in yellow are reflective of the areas in which the curriculum standards changed, and that process stems back to 2009 in the beginning, then moving to 2010, at the point in which the State Department of Education had begun its work to modify standards, change the rigor of the curriculum, and also modify the rigor in the assessments. And at that point, the state provided opportunity and training for all of the divisions in Virginia to prepare over a 2.5 to 3 year period of time. But again, the highlighted areas in yellow, being English and science, would reflect those updated and more rigorous assessments reflecting the change in the curriculum. I would also mention to you that English is inclusive of several areas, pretty much lumped into one, but English is inclusive of writing, reading, and also language. And so, also graduation complex index, the benchmark expectation from the state is 85%, and you see that listed as well. To capsule this, I would like to give you a view from the system level. We will break it down into three quick, succinct categories, being elementary, middle, and high school. Before you, you see pass rates for our school's division in reference to a two-year view. You see the subjects across the bottom. You see the color-coded bars reflecting 2011 compared to 2012-13. In red, the red reflects the new and more rigorous adoption in terms of changing curriculum and also the change in the assessment as well as technology and enhancement versions that were before all school divisions for the first time this year. You see where we are with history over a two-year period of time. You see where we are with mathematics, which shows a slight increase for us at this point. You also see across three areas, the newly adopted areas, that we show sharp declines in those areas compared to where we were in reference to those new standards. If we move forward, the same concept applies in reference to middle. If you take a moment to do a quick view of that, in the same way that we did elementary, you see where we are with history. You see also somewhat of an increase in mathematics. But again, consistent with the previous slide, you see the dips in reference to reading, writing, and science, which reflect the new standards and the more rigorous assessment.
Dr. King, I see yes. The increase in math. What do you have something that attributes to that, or was it just more rigorous instruction in
well,
math?
We feel as if what the group needs to recall is that the adjustment and the curriculum for mathematics, it began in the year of 2009. The first new and accountable adjustment as far as rigor and changes really took place the year prior, not 2012-13, but in 2011-12.
Okay.
And so the system experienced dips. Okay. During that point.
Okay.
This
okay.
is the second year
okay.
of the new and more rigorous assessment,
okay.
meaning, you know, more alignment,
okay.
more focus, and more readiness with what that subject area now really assesses.
The teachers had a better opportunity to prepare themselves and the students in the area of math.
Second year.
And this is, okay.
Yes, absolutely. Okay. It's the second year. So we feel that our people that are really the decision makers and make it happen in the classroom knew a lot more about the necessities here, thus
okay.
the improvement that we see.
Okay. So the same pattern should happen
next
with
year.
Science, reading,
okay.
and writing.
Okay,
right.
that's what I was thinking. Thank you. Okay.
Sure. Okay. And again, the same concept in reference to the dips with reading, writing, and science with the new standards. We move forward to the last view, the high school view, using the same concept. You see where we are with history, as well as mathematics, and you also see a similar concept with the decline across the newly tested areas, the modification of the curriculum related to reading, writing, science, of course, new standards. So same concept there. So it gives you a picture in terms of a graphic representation of where we are as a school system, elementary, middle, and high school level related to SOL.
So the changes were phased in?
Yes, yes, yes. And the next and last phase should be history, social studies, which is coming.
History actually also went through one more recently, and unfortunately, there was a huge decline in the state with that. But that history adjustment did not have the technology enhancement items on it as the one will in 2015. It will be just like these other three tests this year with.
All right. With that said, I would like to move quickly to overall system view.
I got a question.
Yes, sir.
I'm looking at this, and I'm looking at from elementary to middle to high school. Mm-hmm. The students are doing better in reading, writing, and science, as well as math in high school, opposed to middle and elementary, where you get the basic foundation.
Right, and we and
how do you quantify it? You're not getting the basic foundation of K through five, and how these shop, pre-K through five.
Right.
But then they are doing well in high school.
Well, a number of things I think we can consider. One would be that we're dealing with the end of course test approach, which in some cases, of course, relates to the particular subject. After it's taught over a period of time, it could be one semester, it could be two semesters, so it's condensed and pretty succinct in terms of the standards that should be rolled out in the classroom. And so in a course test compared to an SOL assessment at elementary level in middle school, there are some differences and variance in terms of that whole assessment. Now, we're going to look deeper with that, of course, but the elementary level and middle school level assessments really reflect a cumulative body of work and learning from the beginning of the school year until the end. And so in some cases with the EOC, there are some differences there in terms of being pretty definitive around what those standards are over a shorter period of time, which could impact.
Am I dealing with less students? Am I the numbers that we're losing incorporated in this?
I don't have before me the number of students that are reflected in the high school results, but we can get
from
that.
From middle to high school, we do know that we lose a number of young people.
Right.
So is that reflected in these numbers to see the spike upward as it relates to English, writing, science, or even math?
It does reflect the change in the numbers of students because these results reflect the body of students that were tested. And if you go back and think about elementary and the number of elementary students that we have, those students tend to stay with us through elementary school. We begin to lose some students from elementary to middle.
So that's why I want to understand what when I look at these numbers, I understand them. But,
I want to be a snapshot. You're looking at a snapshot.
Snapshot, right. I want to know if that's a part of it.
There's also some discussion about whether or not in elementary school, one teacher is responsible for teaching the math SOL, the science SOL, the English SOL. Versus when they get to middle school, those teachers are specialized in those subjects. And so all day long, they are reiterating and they are learning, they're obtaining professional development on just one subject versus the elementary teachers who are really having to become the experts in all of the subjects. Some districts are starting to subspecialize their elementary teachers for the SOLs, to where they just have, for example, in the fifth grade, a certain number of math teachers that just teach the math course. And I don't want to overstep you know, your comments, but that's part of the discussion too.
So you're saying in elementary level, you could have one teacher who's responsible for the entire thing?
Everything. And she has to be on top of every single item that is on the SOL. Everything that's handed down from Virginia, the state, they're responsible for.
Elementary is not always departmentalized. In some cases, there's some semi-departmentalization where in the fifth grade, certain teachers might teach science and mathematics, for example, and you may have some others that might teach the literacy and the social studies. However, once you hit the high school level, you have more specialization.
Right. That's my question. Well, right. That's why I'm looking at the numbers and I'm trying to understand, because you begin to take...
Yeah, the numbers look better at high school in terms of percentages meeting and exceeding.
Yeah, right. That's why I'm trying to understand why.
And those are some things that we'll continue to look at, because there are some implications for the work early on to get them ready and for high school and to be successful in high school. And if we take a look at where we are with some of the elementary results, then it has implications for wanting to rest assured that once we hit high school, we can maintain higher level performance than what's here, because that's what's going to have to happen. Even still.
Another thing too, Anthony, is that at the high school level, you can't graduate unless you pass an SOL test, whereas elementary and middle school, you technically can continue to move forward without passing an SOL test because the state can't hold you back. We don't want that to happen, obviously, but it's a little bit different at the high school level when a kid can't walk across the stage unless they pass that test. They're going to take it seriously.
They have more incentive.
Yes.
And credit recovery comes into play. So if you fail a course and you do retake it.
You can't do that at all. Yeah. You're in the middle.
Okay. All right. So if we move forward with the analysis at the elementary, in the aggregate, the middle, and the high school, there's certain quick conclusions that we can draw, of course, many of which you see very quickly, and you've alluded to some of those. Major dips were experienced, of course, in especially in the newly adopted curricular areas, being reading, writing, and science. We talked about when the state started its adoption and changing the curriculum. Also, first year for new technology-enhanced items across those same subject areas. So major changes in the assessment itself, also major changes in the curriculum itself, but again, built in over a period of approximately 3 years to be ready for this whole rollout. And with that said, more schools are projected to fall into the accredited with warning category, which means this previous year we had several schools that were fully accredited but made it through the three-year averaging process. And so when you make it through the three-year averaging process, and then you have an increase in the benchmark in terms of the percentage of students that are expected to meet and exceed, then it also causes schools to be somewhat vulnerable in terms of whether they're going to miss an AMO or not. Because if you miss one AMO, then it causes you to be one or more.
AMO, so, meaning for AMO. People who are looking.
Academic Measurable Objective.
Thank you.
One area, one subject area. Yeah. And so we did have quite a few schools, I think around 11, that fell into that category in terms of making it through the three-year average. And then we project and predict that these schools will fall into the accredited with warning category as a result of that. And basically, interestingly enough, we also predict that that will be in the subject area of mathematics. Although we did see some increases in math across the board. However, with the dips, once you hit a baseline and then you improve, you still have a certain amount of growth that you must experience to move in the appropriate direction. We provided for you the ratings again, and you're very familiar with these, from fully accredited, provisionally accredited, accredited with warning, accreditation denied, conditional, et cetera. That's just for your information. I will remind the group that nothing is official as it relates to accreditation until the latter part of September, when the state will provide that information. All of the information and analyses that we've provided thus far reflect internal analyses in terms of what we feel we see to determine the implications for developing the strategies for improvement going forward. So again, remember that this is not official, but we felt that it was important to begin those projections so that we could start early with the work that's necessary. If we move forward to the next piece, continuing overall system performance, I talked about the deep declines across those areas. Also, it is interesting to note that outside of those newly tested areas, the newly adopted curricular areas, we show improvement. When you take a look at the increases in student performance in mathematics and history, subject areas, those areas are not inclusive of the newly adopted curriculum. So those are outside of the first year of accountability for the new curriculum. At the elementary level, in reference to those areas, there was improvement experienced in reference to meeting and exceeding standards in 3 out of 5 of math and history areas. So students improved approximately 60% of those areas outside of the newly adopted curricular areas. In middle school, improvement in reference to percentage of students meeting and exceeding standards also in 3 out of 5 math and history areas. So we did see those positives. Lastly, high school improvement in reference to percentage of students meeting and exceeding as it related to end of course tests. We improved in 6 out of 7 of those math and history slash geography areas. And so about 86% of those areas reflected improvement outside of the newly adopted curricular areas. And so you see the net effect there. So, you know, we consider that a positive. And if we go back and take a look at the next slide that move forward, rather than take a look at the next slide, represents a quote from the state superintendent of public education. And if you take a look at that, they predicted early on that in the area of science, we would see a decline across the division. And with my recollection, the approximate amount of decline that the state predicted and projected was about a 20% decrease in science. They also predicted that we'd see a decrease in divisions across the state in reference to the writing, the reading, and language with the technology-enhanced items, and that from a literacy standpoint, the percentage, average percentage of decline would have been around 10%. So you see, this is the quote that they provided during the month of August, a few days ago. So what does that mean for us moving forward? And I'm going to move pretty quickly through this. You know that we developed board and division priorities as a governance leadership team this past school year. We did not have a 5-year strategic plan in place, so that was the major step one for us to begin that process. To the right, you will see the strategic planning process that we spent a year in terms of beginning the development to provide direction for us, purpose and vision for us in terms of those things that are important for the school system related to the needs of children. The only other item I'll mention in reference to that is that we brought together a group from the community made up of about 32 individuals to enter into some major troubleshooting and decision-making. That first item of business for them was to develop community beliefs. You see that before you and on the screen. They developed 11 community beliefs. Those community beliefs are reflective of those things that should impact directly or indirectly the business of education in Norfolk. And so you see those items on that first page. You see the first one. I'm not gonna read those to you except to say the first one relates to believing that every person is worthy of respect, and the last one relates to the whole diversity piece, and you can read the remainder. We move forward to the next community belief developed by that group of 32 individuals from the community. I would add that they were required to reach agreement around the development and writing of these particular beliefs, not consensus, so they could not move forward if there was some discourse or disconnect between any of these items. So these are truly community beliefs around what's important for public education in Norfolk. So you see the last page reflecting those 11 items, and I'll draw your attention to the first. It speaks to effective educators and staff. The last one speaks to students, families, and schools expecting and having responsibility for safe and secure environment. So you have an opportunity to take a closer look at those. The next item, as I move quickly, for that group was to begin to set us on a course that would be, that would have a laser-like focus on what our purpose should be as a school system, as well as what our, of course, purpose and mission, but also what our vision should be. As we take a look into the future, determine the highest aspirations for the organization, and develop strategies to take us there, what should that look like? In bold print, you see the visionary phraseology that that group developed. The group said that this school system, Norfolk Public Schools, should strive to become the cornerstone of a proudly diverse community. And they said that that's not what we are right now. Because in any visionary reference, one should read it, and that should be the response. Because if you're truly there already, then it's not visionary. So that was very important from that group to us. The last piece, purpose. The purpose that they developed was to for us to ensure that we take care of the academic piece, as well as the affective domain around making students college and career ready, and to prepare them for lifelong learning. And you see the bullets that are there to provide the means to carry that out. From there, they were challenged and charged with the task of developing parameters. Parameters are defined as those things that that group developed around items that must not be violated as we continue to plan, in addition to items that must not be violated as we implement. And we have begun implementation of the first year this month, the month of August. So you see that those items are very powerful in terms of what we cannot violate moving forward, nor could we violate as we continue to plan and implement. The next task was to develop the objectives. There are four of those, and I would just simply draw your attention to the common term all. That group of 32 individuals was pretty adamant about, after extensive conversation, adamant about the fact that if you're going to develop a five-year strategic plan, the plan should be structured to be successful with all students, not just some, not just 85%, not just 90, not just 95, but developed in a way that it is aiming at what is indicative of success for all children. And if you fall short, then you simply adjust, modify your strategies going forward to address those needs. The last item for that group was to develop the five strategies. These are the overarching strategies to lead and guide us for the next 5 years. Those should be before you. You can read those, and you see that it runs the gamut from safety and security to teaching and learning, to the cornerstone piece, to the investment and the community implications for wraparound services that are necessary, and as well as relentlessly pursuing engaged learning through high-quality instruction. I will remind the group that although these are five strategies, within each of those strategies, you'll find multiple action plans and action steps across each. The document itself, the five-year strategic plan, if we were to download it, would be approximately 200 pages. It is on the website. You can click on any of these items. You can go to any particular strategy and see the items that are important for this first school year, because it is in phases. We're in phase one now. Phase one will be year one implementation and year two implementation, and we're beginning that process as we speak. The next piece reflects what we refer to as our schematic for success for the entire school district, all of the schools, 100% of the schools, referred to as the cycle for results. Simply put, I would draw your attention to the five essential questions on the left, which really gives you a good idea of the flavor of the cycle for results, which centers on knowing that the appropriate elements of the standards that they're taught, knowing the curriculum is taught, know that it is aligned with what the state expects children to learn. Secondly, at what rate of children are children learning? If they are struggling, where are the safety nets? How do we know it? What is the evidence? If students are, as students excel, providing enrichment and having the evidence there to provide a clear indication that students are excelling. And from there, what does the teacher do when the student performs beyond that expectation sentence on that same notion, that same tenet, but what is the concrete evidence of enrichment for those students? So really honing in on individual needs of students aligned with what children should know and be able to do, but a viable, relevant, pertinent curriculum aligned with the SOLs and ensuring that that happens. We are in the midst of ongoing training with building level leaders and teachers from the central level as well to ensure that these things are in place and that we're moving forward in an aligned fashion. And that's for the entire school division linked to this strategic plan. The next piece we'll move into, which is the last component, speaks to transforming schools and the transformation initiative that is proposed. A few months back, we presented some information to the board around a proposal for 10 schools. And we arrived at those 10 schools based on an analysis over the entire year that it reflected common formative assessment results that also reflected benchmark results as well as other teacher-made assessments. And after that analysis, we arrived at the fact that these are 10 schools in phase one that could benefit from additional resources, additional support to begin to transform the whole notion of where those schools are and where we need to be going forward. Before you have the list of those schools and a planned theme for the school, I would remind you that the theme is an additional piece to provide professional development for building level leaders to be more effective and also to provide professional development for teachers in the classroom to become even more effective with their delivery of instruction. In the same way that a teacher that teaches advanced placement coursework must be endorsed to do that. And simply put, they are taught strategies that allow them to have students retain knowledge at a much higher level, at a much higher rate than you would otherwise. But embedded within each one of these packets that will be presented to the board next month in September for their review, and then we'll talk further in October, will be embedded the tenets of success tied to improving student achievement for each school and what it means for these themes that are also attached. With that will be partners that we are going to bring to the table to help work and support the schools. The next piece around transformation centers on what does it mean in terms of public conversion charter. You've heard a lot about the recommendation in terms of going forward with a public conversion charter aspect. And so why? Why is that important? The things that are important for us in regards to that recommendation, it really is around being able to have more time for children. If you take a look at those results, we know that we have children that are reading below grade level, and we know that we must do a better job with getting children on grade level and above by the end of third grade. That's really the answer, and we know that. And so, in order to begin to close those gaps and transform, we need more time, whether it's extended literacy blocks, whether it's extended numeracy blocks, that relates to the master schedule day to day. Also, we would like to have more time as it relates, time and flexibility as it relates to the school calendar itself. At this point, we are, of course, forced to start after Labor Day. We want to have some flexibility around having a hybrid calendar that would allow us to redistribute those days to get a fall intercession and a winter intercession so that we can bring children back that might not have gotten it during that regular time period, and also provide transportation, but give customized services based on the elements of standards around which they were deficient, as well as enrichment. Those students that were high flyers, bring them back to stretch them, to challenge them. And that also means expansion of the gifted program and all those things that come into play. We are working with the state in discussions because at this point on the books, there's only a description of traditional charter schools, not public conversion charters. So we're in ongoing discussion with the state around what that's going to mean. And so we are reflecting that in our packets as we move forward, as well as the lottery aspects of it. The traditional language centers on lotteries for a school. So we are working with that piece as well, and we'll know more soon about what that's going to look like, and it will be described in each individual packet provided to the board. The next piece gives you a timeline that we feel that we will continue to function. We're in preparation phase, moving quickly into phase one and phase two. Again, we plan to bring information to the board and the public around what these individual packets for each school will entail, as well as have the board to take some robust discussion and take action possibly in October. That is the intent. Highlights, district-wide transformation. These are some things that are reflective across the system. These are things that you should be very, very familiar with in reference to literacy and the things that we need to do at the elementary and middle level. Also, numeracy. The third bullet relates to the fact that we have modified the gifted program to add additional services to those students that qualify and to identify additional students that qualify that should receive services. 5-year strategic plan across the board for all schools, 100%. The cycle for results, the schematic that I mentioned earlier, training for 100% of our schools in reference to what that means. So in closing, you know, we have the transformation initiative as a recommendation, but that is a component and an offshoot of the strategic plan. The strategic plan itself relates to 100% of the schools for going forward for the next 5 years, and the schematic related to student achievement and the cycle for results is an emphasis for all of our schools. So with that, I'm going to close the comments here, and we will entertain questions and comments. Dr. Houston.
Yes, and just before we do so, I would just make mention, question may be looming, so that's what the district is doing. What is the board doing? And I would say that our responsibility as a board is to continue to look at several things. One, to look at to ensure that we have the right policies in place, to make sure that we have the right plan in place. And so the strategic plan, our responsibility is to make sure that we can see clearly how the strategic plan ties to and equals student performance, making sure we have the right people in place. We talked in the budget about math and reading specialists, making sure that we have highly qualified and highly effective teachers in every classroom, and then making sure we have the right process in place. Dr. King talks about the cycle of results. That's the process that's being used at the school level, but at the board level, we must have the right process in place to ensure accountability, a mechanism where we know that what's supposed to happen is actually happening, and then, of course, ensuring that professional development is continuing to take place. So those are the areas of focus for the board to ensure that all that's supposed to happen in the district. As mentioned at the technical level and the practical level by the superintendent, ways that we know that they're happening, that we're doing our job in providing the correct leadership and support in the way of policy making and budget provisions. With that, we'd like to turn it back over to the mayor for questions and answers.
Dr. King, thank you for the presentation. I personally, and I think I speak for members of the council, I mean, we have great confidence in your leadership, at least speaking for myself, other council members can speak, and in the leadership of the board. I personally think we have a great team in place to move the system forward. I am filled with a sense of urgency, though. I mean, and I want to help, and I think the council wants to help, and I don't know, I mean, and I want to start tomorrow. I mean, I want to start tonight. I mean, we have to improve these scores. We have to get all our schools accredited. I mean, you have a forum here that you don't have very often. You have all the city council here with you. I mean, how can we support what you're doing? I mean, I know it's a question of resources, and we balance a lot of that stuff. I mean, what else can we do? Is there other things we can help you with? Because we know you have a heavy load here.
Sure. Of course, I mentioned the notion of time. Flexibility, time, and understanding the fact that even with master schedules, that we're going to have to be very creative and innovative in terms of what we do in one school as it relates to a master schedule compared to another. In other words, that means that each school is customized based on the needs of its children. And so much of that is embedded in what we are proposing transformation-wise, but certainly across the board, even with the cycle, ensuring that that's happening. This is the first opportunity that all of the building level leaders have come forward to present their master schedules linked to the needs of schools. And the team, the central office team, was there to hear that, to ensure that it really did reflect those strengths and those weaknesses. So from a support mechanism, we must continue to partner in a way that we ramp up the needs that reflect a child or families, or a family that sends a child to school. That you always hear me use the example at the kindergarten level, where one student has heard X percentage of vocabulary terms to and compared to another. Simply put, they're already behind. And so when they enter school with those gaps. And so that does not mean that the child doesn't have good people at home or a good family. It just means that parents could be working two jobs, or educational levels in the households might not be such that they have a print-rich environment. Well, long story short, that has implications for our work. That means that we have to partner with other entities to be able to reach the early learning piece, because all the research is clear around what success means in urban systems, especially when you look at our demographics and that kind of thing. It centers on literacy at the early level. So that means adding our pre-K programs, which we have begun to do that, but you know, we're limited in terms of capacity. It also means, what about those in-home daycares that are licensed? What about those satellite caregivers that are out there that are taking care of infants, toddlers, and four-year-olds? We know we need to be able to partner with those entities to provide professional development to those entities, because those children are going to be ours in a few years. And so we can not only begin to close achievement gaps, but begin to eliminate them. So that kind of thinking, along with what we're doing with the partnership, early learning partnership here already, and reaching out to provide services in a way that those children are ready when they enter. The other piece is that embracing the whole notion of enrichment too. And that's why we talked about those students that are already on standard and exceeding. So we talked about being able to have the capacity to identify more students that are classified and qualified as gifted in literacy or numeracy. Being able to provide those services from endorsed gifted teachers to take them to the other level. So all ends of the spectrum. So essentially what I'm saying is to continue to form that partnership between the school system and the community around the social services piece. We have created a student support services department because that's how critical it is. We have to have prevention intervention counselors to go in and work with caseloads of students and in order to see us turn the tide. And there are many, many positives even within these numbers around what children are already doing in terms of being high flyers, but we need to see that grow to an exponent as well. So that's the kind of support that I think is important, but also understanding that, you know, we're in the process of moving into the process of building schools and all that comes into play.
Dr. Hume, if you can just keep it simple for me. What page did I miss it that discusses the short term, what we're gonna do to improve the test scores? Was it 31 schools? I know we got the 10 that you projected. You figured the 10 were ones that needed the extra help.
Right.
What are we going to do? What is the plan on that? I could have missed it because I was getting water a couple of times. Are we adding teachers? Are we making classrooms smaller? What are we doing? Because I think that's what the people want to know. Short term, what are we going to do tomorrow?
Pupil-teacher ratios are at a level that we would prefer. So we feel good about where we are with pupil-teacher ratios. The real key for us now is for professional learning, for teachers becoming even more effective with what they do, principals becoming better at what they do as well, more effective with what they do. But the key now, too, is that we have an aligned, viable curriculum at each level. We call that a scope and sequence. So now teachers know what should be taught, how that's aligned to the SOL.
Okay.
We had a week of training last week, mm-hmm. for principals and their staffs to take a look at that alignment. That was one missing piece for us in the previous year. And the missing piece centered on the fact that we know that there were some examples that the scope and sequence that was being rolled out in some classrooms really centered on the old scope and sequence that was already there prior to the change in the curriculum.
How were they missing that? I mean, in God's honest truth, I mean, in my job, I have to keep up. And there are times I may not know what the Supreme Court did yesterday, and I could be embarrassed, but hopefully I'm over that and I can work through it. How was it that principals missed it? I can't fathom that they missed it knowing where they were. Is that what it was? Or I know you and your team have just come in. I'm not indicting you.
Sure. Well,
you got to tell us what the cause is.
The root cause centered on, if you go back and think about the fact, the adoption and changes started in 2009 with mathematics, and then moved into 2010 in reference to reading, writing, science, etc. When that happens, there are clearly delineated steps that are supposed to take place. One is that the state modifies the curriculum. The state modifies the curriculum, that means it modified the standards. It ramped up the standards, made the standards more rigorous, provided that information to the district levels across the state. That happened 2009, 2010.
Right.
At that point, as the district receives its training at the state level, it must then develop its transition plan, each individual system. Develop its transition plan, which should be reflected pulling your old scope and sequence, which is the current curriculum that systems use.
I was going to ask you what that means.
Parallel it with the new, which would be the new standards, and do what we call unpacking standards. Modify your old scope and sequence to reflect the new scope and sequence, which means that now we've modified from the old to the new, which is what we are preparing to give to our teachers to say, here are the elements of the standards that you must teach each day throughout the semester.
Did we miss that at that time? I know we weren't the only division that missed it.
No. Well, we received, prior to my arrival, a review from the Council of Great City Schools. The Council of Great City Schools report was very clear. It said that there was a clear disconnect between what teachers were teaching in the classroom and the new, more rigorous curriculum. Therefore, now, let's talk about that just a brief minute. That's not a teacher's fault.
Whose fault is it?
Well, I'm not going to place blame on anybody. I'm going to talk about process.
Okay. Right?
Process consists of, once the training is done, once the scope and sequence is developed at the system level, the system level then should pull in a cadre of teachers, a cadre of principals. You sit, you take a look at what you have compared to the old and the new, and you vet it out as quality. Then you do what we call trial runs. That's why you have 2.5 to 3 years to do this. You do what we call trial runs in the school. Then you modify your benchmarks, your assessments, to align with the new curriculum. Those benchmarks are the assessments that's going to tell you in a formative sense where children are struggling early.
Right.
If you've not modified your benchmarks and you've not changed your curriculum, teachers don't know the change from what they were teaching to the new. And so the process is that at the central level, we would provide that training, deliver that to teachers, train teachers to make that shift, and then hold all accountable for what those numbers are telling us. So in addition to the Council of Great City Schools audit, we did internal audits. We also pulled in the Virginia School Superintendents Association to do another audit. The common thread running through that centered on the exact precise thing of which we speak at this point. So when teachers are teaching from a scope and sequence that they feel is appropriate, and they've not been told differently, then children may be learning at very high levels based on that scope and sequence. Mm-hmm. But then if you're tested over a different curriculum,
fair enough,
then you get the disconnect.
And that, I assume, occurs, you having found that, you have dealt with that within your administration to make sure that doesn't happen.
Yes, we now have an aligned curriculum based on the new standards and those assessments. And we're in the process of putting that out in a way that the community can see it.
But you're still going to have kids. Again, the one thing about this is that, you know, although you could hit the reset button, we got kids that are going through the system every year.
Yes.
And that doesn't stop.
Right.
So when you start to teaching these kids the new, when you start teaching these teachers how to teach the new curriculum and what you should be teaching to the various grade levels, there are kids that didn't get it.
That's right.
At this grade.
That's right.
And they're expected to get it here.
That's right.
But they missed it here.
Yes.
Okay, so you're going to still have some kids lagging behind because they didn't get. So, I'm going to let you finish because I want to.
That's why time is important.
That's right, yeah.
That's the time piece. And that's the answer to the questions around what do we need to do to support this effort.
Well, so that's a longer day, calendar?
It could be an extended version of a literacy block for some students. If they're two or three grade levels behind in reading, then they need to get what we call a double dose of literacy. If it's a mathematics issue, then extended block in numeracy. The reason we want the hybrid calendar is so that we can get those intersessions where we can bring students back for an additional week in addition to safety nets during the day to hone in on these deficiencies. Because if you're 2 years behind, like we speak, the only way you're going to do it is to accelerate the rate at which you provide those services to those children that are behind, and at the same time, extend and enrich those children that are already getting it. And so that's why transformation is being proposed in the way that it is. Of course, we are tweaking every day as we go, but there are very specific common threads that must happen across all schools.
Just a second, wait, Tom.
Yeah. Okay, if you'll indulge me for just a minute, I'm gonna get teacher on you. And I want you to review some data, which is what we do all the time in education. We're data-driven, and we're looking at data.
I'm not sticking around for a test.
Oh, well, you probably won't pass it under the new standards.
teacher's fault.
First, let me explain something to you. First, I want to thank the school board and Dr. King for being transparent with the results, because they released those results, and we made it on the front page of the paper for people to beat us up. And as you can see in today's paper, Chesapeake announced that they are going to have schools that aren't accredited, and it's already shifted to the second page, and nobody's making comments. It's got three comments. And I can guarantee you, and I made comments this weekend on the blog, that the other districts in the area that have schools that are not accredited, you will see the schools that come from neighborhoods that have a higher poverty level and what the assault of Virginia Department of Education is on our schools. So what I wanted to do is I took it home to Little Creek Elementary in Ward 5. I had two elementary schools in Ward 5 that were not accredited this year, and Little Creek was one of them. But it was fully accredited up until this year. So I wanted to give you some data on this to show you the reason why they are not accredited is because of math. They were accredited last year because they made the three-year average. And you can see in yellow on here that they made gains in math. But it wasn't enough to keep the three-year average, so they moved down there. And you can see what the English and science tests have done. And I'm going to tell you, there's probably no other state in the country that has assaulted their school system the way that Virginia has by loading three brand-new assessments in a two-year period. Other states have phased them in over time. And so you're not given enough time for, particularly in elementary, that they teach all these subjects to be able to adjust to all these changes that are happening. When you think you're getting math right, now you throw reading and science in, and now you got to shift over here and try to get that straight, and you lose some focus in math. It's a difficult task. And so you can see here by these results that Little Creek is actually a pretty good school, and the principal there has a great reputation. I hear nothing but positive comments. But if you look on the second page, I want to point out that look at their free and reduced lunch numbers have been increasing. And those that know me, I've been targeting East Ocean View as an area. If you look at the census tract, I want to point out two things. One, in green, you'll see that these are the tracts, if they're lighter color, are high poverty areas, low income areas. And then in red, you'll see that these are areas where you have single parent households. This is direct data from census that's been taken last year. Well, Little Creek Elementary draws almost all of their kids from that area in the Bay Streets. And so when was asked, what can the city do? The work that you and Angela are doing with the Poverty Commission, you should be looking at data like this. And I ask, why our rec center there has not partnered with the school system necessarily. We're getting there, but we should be offering Achieve 3000 in my access and the math programs that we're offering the school at night so that those kids are also getting it there. GED classes or high school level classes for parents who did not complete, we can bring it back into the community. But the other thing I wanted to show you, just to see how these changed, and I put some of the curriculum here so that you can see, but the next page is an example of an old math question and how the math test used to be. You'll see that it's a simple A, B, C, D choice. The answer's there. So that if a kid who's been taught about stem and leaf plots, which I can't even remember, they can at least figure out because the answer's there if they do it. But now flip to the next page and look at the new type of question that they've put on there on the same topic. These students now have to drag these answers into a plot and submit it. So they could miss one component of that and get the whole question wrong. And so when we look at the blame, yes, there are some gaps with how curriculum has come down, but you also need to start at the Virginia Department of Education and how they roll out these standards. They knew, if you look in the test system, they label these tests with 2009. That's the number that they call it, but it didn't come out until 2011. Ask the teachers when they released the sample test items and when they actually released the roadmaps to them. That is an issue. So Bob McDonald can come down here and say that he's upset that we're saying that you can't take over our schools. But I asked them, what has the Virginia Department of Education, who has faced the same budget cuts as the rest of the school systems across the state, they don't have the staff to necessarily offer the professional development to our teachers to be able to prepare them for these standards. And so it's easy if you continue to flip. You can sit there and say 5.15, the student given a problem situation will collect, organize, interpret data in a variety of forms using stem and leaf plots. But what does that mean for a teacher when they get this? You can release that. But what have you done to help the teachers understand and interpret that and to be able to prepare those kids? You have a lot of our high poverty schools in those areas that are dealing with kids that are coming in well below reading level, and you throw these types of questions in front of them, they're already set up for failure when you haven't even given them the chance to, one, raise their reading level. So we have a lot of work to do, and Dr. King said time. This takes 2 or 3 years. And I can go on about graduation rate and what the state didn't prepare the localities for that and no help with that assistance. And the schools that you see that are continuously failing, and you're going to see this in Virginia Beach and Chesapeake at the end of September, they come from the neighborhoods where you have lower income households. So we've got to go in there and help in these neighborhoods to address these issues. I think it's important for you, any of you, to go on. I was talking to Courtney the other night about everybody should go on there and try to answer these questions on these tests. They're released.
I don't even know what it is.
And you give a third grader, you give a third grader who's dealing with a lot of other issues, you give them this test, it takes more than a year to prepare them for this. And they expected us to do this. So, you know, and the other thing is look who's on the Virginia Department of Education board. You got Winston Sears on there, for crying out loud. Somebody who didn't care about public schools is now on the Virginia Department of Education. Who are these people that are setting policy and sending it down? They don't care about what's happening at Lafayette Winona, but they obviously care now because we're saying, wait a minute here, you're telling us you're going to come and take over our schools and you say you can do it better?
Well, I doubt they're equipped to take over our schools, frankly. But I will tell you this from what I had prepared today, we weren't the only ones. I mean, Richmond was just annihilated.
Petersburg.
As was Chesterfield. Arlington. As was Henrico. As was Hanover. And I mean, and I do agree, but I will also go to the western part of the state where I frequently go visit. I can tell you that in the western part of the state, if you find some of the poorer communities and in the Valley of Virginia, you will see that they also have suffered. So
I put some data online a blog because I was upset that somebody posted something kind of attacking us.
Look at
Cox High School, the premier high school in Virginia Beach. Go look at their SOL scores and see where they are. They're all down in the bottom of the 70s. Now, they're lucky enough that they were started off high enough that the damage, this 20% that the state superintendent predicted, they were still above that 70 threshold. But you have a school who who was already down in the 80s and 70s, you take 20% off, you've wiped them out.
Well, I think that, Paul, the one thing I think that we have to show, and I don't mean to show it, because I think it's part of leadership from not just council, but from the school board and from the superintendent's office, is, that's why I would ask you that we need to systematically have updates from the school board, the superintendent's office, prior to our meetings. It could be 5 minutes, it could be 10 minutes, especially right now. We are at too critical a time in the city's future dealing with this. Regardless of, we can all point blame, not amongst ourselves, but to Richmond. Regardless of that, we have to get out of this. Right. And to get out of that is going to take, it's going to take counsel, it's going to take money. It's going to take, ain't no doubt about it. I don't want to find out about money in March. I want to know about money in November. So we, because then I have to make other votes in November, December, January, February that affect budget and put us maybe in debt on something else. When in reality, back of my mind, I got to say, wait a second, I got something coming from the school board. They've already checked in November. See where I'm coming from? And I think that we need to have them here every week, not the whole board. Not, it could be Brad, it could be Kirk, somebody from the superintendent's office giving us a 5-minute update. This is where we are, guys. We've, you know, this is where our teachers are. This is the update. You know, if you have questions, sure, hit me with an email. We can go offline and you all go about your business. That means more than our little council, you know, requests, frankly. And that should be, we need to get there now. And I'd ask we do that or somehow work it into our schedules and talk to Marcus and let's do that on a weekly basis.
Hold on. Warren and then Anthony, okay? Warren, are you going to say something? And then Paul.
Okay. Go ahead. I know that in a couple of weeks, when all the wonderful people who teach so well our students every day, when they link arms and join hands and walk in those schools together, wonderful things are going to be happening, and they're going to be very proud to hear this conversation is about fixing the problems and not the blame. This is a wonderful tone of conversation, and it's exciting to be part of it. You asked some questions. On your page 23, there's an answer to some of your questions. I can tell you the word more comes to mind. Superintendent asks for more focus and more teacher training almost immediately and began to do that. More time, more involvement, parental and partnership involvement is what's going to come in this transitional initiatives. More of this is going to come. And remember, these are conversion schools. There are schools. On page 21, it says, there are schools with our teachers and our budget and our control. They're not the state's. To your question about where did this happen and where did this come from, think back to 2009, 2010. I was not on the board, but I'm a retired educator and I'm paying attention. There was more poverty, more joblessness, more homelessness, more difficulty, more domestic disruption than we've ever seen in my lifetime in this country. Through all of that, your page 23, the city of Norfolk stood up when the state of Virginia and even the federal government departed. When they deserted us financially, you stood up. Last year, when we came back to you, when the superintendent says, nope, we need item 1 and 2 on page 23, reading specialists and math specialists. You've done it. You did it 3-4 years ago. You did it last year again. You are doing it. And we'll probably be coming to you with more budget requests based on what we learned this year. But those transitional initiatives is asking for more time. And the reason why we have to go through this new mechanism called a charter, it isn't, because these are our schools, these are our faculty, this is our budget, is because we need some of these additional resources. I can tell you, I see my job and have for 40 years, see my job as a board member is removing barriers from the superintendent, his staff, his principals. Their job is to remove barriers from teachers, and their job is to remove barriers from kids. You have been helping throughout difficult times remove barriers from us, and I'm very grateful for all that you've done, but more is what we're going to be coming to you with, I would predict. Thank you very much.
And just a brief comment on that. I mean, there's another partner who's not at our table right now. That's our General Assembly delegation. I mean, I went back and looked, and I guess you can verify the numbers, but since 2007, funding has been cut at the state level. I mean, they had problems, we had problems, by, I think, $20.5 million is what I what I had looked at. So when we need, when we're talking about resources as well, I mean, we would certainly, General Assembly members ought to be sitting in here with us because they bear some of this, some of the responsibility as well.
Is it possible for us to put our the Norfolk Public School, just to duplicate the Norfolk Public Schools request with our General Assembly package that we send every year?
Oh, sure, we can coordinate all those. Now, hold on, hold on. Anthony, and then we'll go to Paul.
I'm glad to see everybody is here as well. But something we've talked about quite some time as relates to Norfolk Public Schools, in the middle schools, and we've said this to previous administrations, we have an abundance of kids that are overage. And I'm going to record and say that because I do want to see that addressed. You know, for me, it's more than just getting kids through the system. You know, with, you know, you got so many layers, so many levels. You talk about test scores, that's great, but at the end of the day, what we're trying to do is build young men and women who can add positively to this community and have choices when they leave the high school, whether they go in the military or whether they go to vocational school or whether they go to college. And I think that's the responsibility that we have. And you don't have to answer that as relates to the middle school issue, but I would like to know what we're doing because that has been out there for quite some time.
I'd like to comment on that. Okay. Because in the proposed transformation initiative, there is an open campus. Okay. Open campus is designed to address the needs of children that are 16 years of age and older, okay, and behind on credits.
All right.
That open campus piece is there and proposed to address the needs of those children. To accomplish really three things: to remove the overage student from the middle school into open campus, to begin to get them back on track, to be ready to go back to the home high school, or to stay and graduate from open campus, whatever the need might be. But that can immediately remove those students, but that's that proposal. The other piece is on high school students that are 16 years of age and older, and so far behind on credits, they can't mathematically graduate from high school.
Right.
And the other piece is to attract back those that have dropped out to come back in so that we can change that whole process. That's the 11th piece for schools. We have 10 schools recommended for public conversion,
okay,
one from a traditional charter piece, and that's what that's about.
How about textbooks? I mean, do we have textbooks in all of our schools, or have we gotten away? I know in some schools I taught, they got away from textbooks, they ran off copies and gave the copies to the kids to take home. But are we getting away from that, or are we going back to textbooks?
We're getting away from textbooks.
We're getting away from textbooks.
But it's an incremental process.
But as you get away from it, are you giving the parents the instruction? Because a lot of these parents have to reinforce what is being taught in the classroom.
Right, right.
So if they're not getting the instructions on how to, before I take math, for example, I taught math. So if they're not getting the example and able to teach that child the same or go over the homework, mm-hmm, by using the examples that they give you in the textbook, then that parent is lost.
Right.
So I would ask that, you know, as we move away from the textbooks, that you still give the parents a guide so they can work with their young people and have an opportunity to be on the same page with the teacher, mm-hmm, by having those examples and teaching it that way.
And that's why we're making it, we're going the incremental route, phasing it in so that we can cover those bases.
And the last thing I offer, again, I go back to here when you have these 10 schools now, you know, I understand, you can correct me if I'm wrong in terms of a Montessori concept. And is that where the kid learn at his own pace?
It does have a pacing piece to it, but it's more of a hands-on problem-solving type of kinesthetic.
Okay, I understand that. I think that we need to look at that as a board, as a community. I think the community need to understand that.
Sure.
Second, Abbott. Yeah, I was a coordinator in Richmond, but so you got it at a high school, but I don't see the feeder.
So at the middle piece too.
Well, I know, but I don't. Which school would it be in?
Yeah, we are looking at developing the feeder pattern for that.
Because if you just have it at the high school, then and not at the middle, because I thought the program you had to have it at a middle school in order to qualify.
There should be a middle school that's listed there as well.
Lake Taylor.
Yeah, Lake Taylor Middle.
I don't have my glasses.
Starting with Lake Taylor Middle. But of course, that doesn't make for the total smooth feeder pattern. Some of those students will be ready to move into the next one, which is Booker T. But we have to add that other piece on.
Right.
Yeah, so we do have it at middle level too.
Mr. Riddick.
Yeah. I don't buy into the fact that poverty is the major contributing factor to children not learning. We've always had poverty of some form in our communities. And I've been seeing these statements about poverty, and I said, well, heck, how back in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, when it was really dire poverty, did we get so many successful college students, doctors, and lawyers from our community? There are a few issues that I believe that would help counteract some of the problems we have in the school. We don't have any discipline in our schools. We don't have any control in our schools. Because of social media and other gadgets and parenting is different. Now, see, children haven't changed, but child-rearing habits have changed. And because of that, we're getting a child that's given a more liberal attitude towards school. We need to get a greater commitment from our children for learning. We have to make the parents more accountable for their children in terms of learning. We need to have more after-school support. Now, we did have about 6 after-school learning centers, but when the budget collapsed 2 or 3 years ago, we closed most of them. We need to find money to have after-school learning centers for children who might come from, quote, dysfunctional homes, who don't have the support at home. They don't have the technology at home. So it's very important that for 2 or 3 hours in the afternoon, maybe not that many, that these children have access to technology, they have access to people who can give them support that they might not be getting at them. And we just need to, and our teachers need more support in their classroom. Now, we talk about classroom sizes and things like that, but we need to go back and get the room mothers, the individuals in the community who are gonna come in, male or female, and volunteer in these classrooms. Our retired community, you know, has a great source, and we just need to go back and tap some of these individuals and ask them to come back. We're also should be able to find some money for some of the educators who've retired, who will come back and get a little stipend, no more than just gas money, who have a great interest in our school district. You'd be surprised. I was talking to a fellow who I go to church with, and he was saying to me that Cliff Harrison, former principal over at Lake Taylor, and we worship at the same hour. And on Sunday, he was saying to me that there are any number of principals and other people who were in our school district who want to come back and help. And so we have to throw that lifeline out there. You know, I mean, it's our entire cities. We're at stake. I was looking at a little commercial about buying a home, and one of the little bullets they had to do with the school, you know, the husband asked the wife, you know, to check the school district. So poverty is not the only contributing factor. It's probably not the major contributing factor. We need to get more discipline in our schools. We need to get more control in our schools. It's ridiculous to allow children to have food fights and for them to be in the school. We need more in school suspension. You know, we have to get these youngsters' attention and let them know that it's a privilege. It is a privilege. I mean, they're not paying for it. Their parents might pay taxes here and there, but it's a privilege. We contribute more than their parents contribute individually for their education, and so we just have to stop playing with them, and we have to stop playing with the youngsters, and stop playing with the parents, and we just have to get a greater commitment. And discipline should be one of our greatest things going into this school year. We should make sure that we take control of our classrooms. Because if a teacher has 55 minutes to teach, and if she has to spend 9 or 11 minutes, you know, with discipline, then he or she can't get their subject matter over. So we just can't look at it saying that, you know, you have poverty and you got pockets of poverty and single parents home. We always had single parents home. So we got to stop looking at excuses and put some fire up under these youngsters and their parents and make them perform.
Thank you.
Yeah, I don't think it's an either or. There's plenty of data around showing the impact of concentrated poverty on schools and outcomes, and I think we have to be willing to look at that data and follow the data and then see where it takes us. But we do spend a lot of time talking about the things that we see that are broken. We don't spend a lot of time examining what's working or the schools that are doing well. And so typically, folks in this room find a way to send their children to schools that are doing well. And I think we can spend some time looking at the formula, the student mix, the culture and climate at the school, and figure out ways that we can replicate what works. Because as we are looking right now at a snapshot in time in terms of school performance for this year or school performance from 2009 to date, if you look at it over a longer period of time, some of the same schools that we have in the transformation initiative, some of the same schools that are under the threat of the OEI, have been schools that have consistently performed at a level that we don't find acceptable over time. And so I think we really have to be willing to look at that data, have some real conversations around what we see. Some of it is going to be difficult to talk about. It's going to involve class. It may involve race. It may involve culture. It may involve a lot of things. But I think we have to find a way to have those discussions and then begin to support the strategic plan that takes us down a pathway towards having that excellence across all school districts. Because we know that, as Tommy was talking about in Ward 5, if you look at Ward 7, even before today, almost all of the schools that are constantly under challenge fall in Ward 7. And then if you layer and map over the neighborhoods that we have that are the higher poverty neighborhoods, they map in Ward 7. And so typically what we have looked at is what can we do to try to make that high poverty situation better. And I just think we also need to add to the mix, what do we do to reduce the level of concentrated poverty that we have in those neighborhoods that then serve those schools? And I think what was started with Broad Creek, trying to have more mixed income, provides us an opportunity to then tie it with the school transformation and reform and begin to look at models then that we can replicate moving forward. But if we stay on the path that we're on where, you know, we have high poverty in one half the city and economic integration in the other half of the city, I think we're always going to find these gaps. And so it may work okay when you look at it at a school level, but when you look at it at a district level and then the impact it has on our city as a whole, I think we're going to have to be willing to peel back that onion and have some tough conversations and look at some solutions for it at a global level.
Paul, where are we? Isn't there a demographic study ongoing?
What?
Where are we? When is that coming?
It is in motion as we speak. We did an RFP for an entity that has done the work in other urban settings.
Right.
They're taking a look at 100% of our schools, looking at capacity, looking at the total number of students enrolled in those schools now, to also look at the socioeconomic factor. What are
so
the poverty
taking
rates?
That to account.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And they will bring us back a comprehensive review and recommendation around even consolidation or school closing, any of those kinds of things, they'll bring back to us.
Well, if we hear from you on a weekly basis, then we'll know when that hits, and it's not going to be read in the pilot memo you hear about.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Although Rodney and I also worship at the same time.
Yes.
I'm still not going to buy into the poverty factor. But what I will say is this. A lot of times, being in the city, we are responsible, because I said a few weeks ago that I think children will do better if they're proud of what their neighborhood looks like. I think sociologists years ago gave a test that gave a child in one community a chance to draw a picture in another. One child drew a picture with flowers in their neighborhood and fences and grass, and the other child just drew up a house with maybe smoke coming out the chimney. So I think we have a responsibility to go into these communities and make these youngsters, when in public housing communities, they look awful. 70% of it is not our fault. But when our youngsters walk out of their homes, they should feel probably just as proud of their communities as anyone else coming. Because there are certain threads that each community should have: curbs, sidewalks, gutters, things of that nature. And those have, believe it or not, a contributing factor to a child's, you know, belief of their self-worth. And so, I don't know. It's a huge issue that we have in front of us, and we can't run from it. We have to face it. And I think everybody around the table, you know, have had some very good points, and we just have to put them all together. But we have to remember Monday, school starts, on Tuesday? Tuesday. School starts on Tuesday. Right. So we have to hit the ground running.
Right.
Yeah.
Why don't we, sure.
A couple things. The first thing I do want to do is reiterate my support of you, where the mayor, in his initial comments, because I do believe that you're doing a really good job, and I know you had probably like a bowl of yak to work with, and you are just working that out. And so I know that we've had some issues over time, and it is just going to take some time to, you know, to make those issues, to put those in perspective. But I also want to comment on something that Mr. Riddick said in terms of, you know, what we're dealing with, and it's not poverty. I think poverty is also different than it was years ago as well. And I think the emphasis of education in homes is different. We may have had poor people, but poor parents knew that in order for their children not to be poor, their children needed to get an education. And so to break that cycle, they made sure that their kids went to school, they made sure that their kids did their homework, they made sure that, you know, they had the things that, you know, was necessary. So while we look at the numbers and we can point to poverty, but just like parenting has changed and a lot of different things have changed, the poverty and the importance of education in homes and among people has also changed. And that's a problem that I don't have a solution to, as to how do you change individuals' attitudes about education so that they can pass on a better attitude about education to their children, and how they can pass on an importance about education, what you can do, what you can become, how you can break the cycle of poverty through education. So that's just something to, you know, keep in mind. We look at poverty and it's easy to just say it's poverty and there are poverty neighborhoods, and I don't dispute the data at all, but I think that there has to be something that we can work on as a community of people to reinstill the importance of education to the parents, because parents have that level of influence on their children that it doesn't matter what you do in some cases in school. If the parents are not reinforcing it at home, it's like pouring water in a bucket with a hole in it. It just seeps right back out. And I agree with Mr. Riddick again on you know, discipline. I know there's only so far we can go, you know, according to the law. But I think that looking at every aspect of discipline and holding, you know, parents accountable for the actions of their children is a very important thing. But I overall, you know, I believe we're on the right track. And I hope that next year, this time, we will be having a very different conversation. It still may be a difficult conversation, but I think that we will be having a very different kind of conversation where we will be showing improvement based on the things that you're putting in place that we haven't had in a very long time.
Okay, I'm gonna wrap it up here. Marcus, maybe as soon as our next meeting, we can, I guess it's the 10th, right? We can carve out some time for the council here. Can you talk about what we think we can do? I mean, I think some of the infrastructure issues that Paul talked about, learning center issues. Maybe you can let us know whether you think that's a, you know, learning center pieces, whether that's appropriate, this stuff about trying to get our rec centers more involved in the evenings. You know, our approach could be from the public safety issues and the neighborhoods where these kids go to school. You know, that the manager's office would look at the location of some of the schools that didn't perform well, or as well as we wanted, and see what we can do to try to improve the environment. So when they get to school, maybe they're better prepared to learn. But we can have some of that discussion next week. And this thing that Andy brought up about how you can effectively and in a timely and a regular way of reporting to us, what's the best way to do that? So we, and then maybe as soon as October, have another meeting. It might, you know, I don't know. I mean, why don't y'all think it over? But it might be good to have a General Assembly member sitting in here with us as well. You know, if you, we'll see. Look at everybody's cutting their eyes out. But I mean, maybe it's a good idea to get some of them in here because we are, you know, they will have to shoulder some of this with us. You know, I mean, I know they want to help, and maybe we'll ask them to help.
Let's bring them back in 2 weeks, Paul. We're not meeting next week. Now we at least get a report on how the first week, 2 weeks is.
Oh, we can get a report in here on the 10th for sure.
Yeah.
But some of the, I mean, maybe towards early October we have another meeting like this. I think the discussion's been great.
Paul, can we?
Brad whispered to me, he thought it was too, so I'm not sure.
Paul, can we schedule a lot of our, I won't say a lot, but our retreat is coming up.
Sure.
And I think it would be important to get that data with the schools that are low performing and where they're coming from by our retreat, and maybe even have some of our school officials during that period in the retreat so that we can have a healthier, longer conversation. This was a start, but we've got to, like Andy said, have it sooner. But I think the retreat would be a good opportunity to have you guys, and we have a bigger conversation in the community.
Well, Paul sent me a text last night, and with the notion that the school board get involved in our retreat, and my thought was, well, maybe we could set aside a day with you. I mean, to have a retreat and then have our own retreat. I don't know,
but I think that's a great idea.
You know, just to get everybody in the room for a few hours. You talk to us, and we can go and try to.
We've come in no other quarters.
Oh, I'm sorry. But, I mean, so we can try to find a day in the next, before long where we could have that retreat,
so,
all of us together. I mean, this is an all-hands-on-deck moment, if there ever was one. So, okay. Noelle, did you want to talk to Ron?
Well, I've thoroughly enjoyed the conversation. I think that collaboration is key, and I'm glad that we're all in support of the students of Norfolk Public Schools, because there is wonderful things that happen in the school system. But Mayor Frame, you had asked initially, what can the city do to help us out? And I think that one of the steps in looking forward into preparing our students is going to be pre-K education. Right now, as of last year, we had about almost 600 children on a wait list to attend pre-K. And kindergarten teachers fight for students who have been in pre-K because they come to their classrooms prepared with the skills, not just academic skills, but just social skills. And I would like to see our district be able to accommodate every single child for pre-K, and not just those children that qualify for Title I, but for every child. My children, I have a 3- and 4-year-old. I pay a lot of money for daycare. It's Old Dominion Child Study Program. It's wonderful. And I would like for them to be able to have that opportunity in Norfolk Public Schools, even if it means paying some tuition. But I think that if we can develop that program in a short term, a very short term, to be able to bring these kids in, get them on track, experience learning in a fun way, hopefully bring in some of those middle-class families that are going to be the classroom mothers, and get them excited about learning, I think that it will start a good trend in Norfolk Public Schools. So when we look at our budget and we come to you early in November to be first in line, I know that I'm going to be asking for pre-K for all of these 600 children that are on the wait list. And if it means that we have to rebalance our budget to accommodate that, then we're willing to have that conversation also, because we can't just take and take and take. We need to figure out what works well and what doesn't work well. But that is an area that I see some excellent gains in for the city and definitely for the students.
And just quickly, I'll just echo a bit about the budget part. I do think it's a good idea to come earlier, to be honest, and put on the table what our forecast is going to be in the years to come, especially as we embark on the transformation agenda. We have these 10 schools as part of each packet. There's going to be a price tag associated with it. And so we need to know what that is. We'll see that shortly. But if that's a rich package, we need to know that earlier than later for all intents and purposes. And then secondly, I think transparency is key too. We have history coming down the pike, right, in 2015, mm-hmm. in terms of an SOL. And I think if in a very small, that's a small way, if we can demonstrate now how we're going to articulate and live up to the process that Dr. King has said we are going to do in order to unveil, unwrap, and deploy that new curriculum for history, so that the consumer, the family, the child, the community knows that we're going to do what we say we're going to do, I think that's very important as well. So if we can do that in a very transparent way, I think it's a very small way that we can begin to get the confidence of the public back. But I think wherever else we can be transparent, that's key as well. I'd also like just to thank you all for having us here today. I think this is a great start of a great conversation, and I like the idea of having more of these.
I don't know how we would do it, but we ought to seize the moment. If there are, in fact, and we know there are other school districts all across the Commonwealth whose scores went down, that finally we actually, you know, all got together, somehow stepped up, and went to the General Assembly and said, you know, you need to fulfill your constitutional obligation to provide the fundings for the standards of quality that our children need. And, you know, in this next budget, you know, ought to be the budget for education. And we ought to demand people who are running for office to lay that out for statewide office. So,
BSBA is having a forum September 30th on challenge schools.
BSBA would be what?
Virginia School Board Association.
Okay.
And part of that work is around representatives from various parts of the state looking at the issue, and be glad to forward that information on. So if any of the council members or others are available to attend, that's going to be one place where that discussion is going to be had.
But I think we also have to do that when we're looking at spending money.
Oh, I know.
I mean, we have to know ahead of time if we're going to put ourselves in debt, we're going to buy a piece of property, we're going to enter into a joint venture. We need to know in September, November, we've got something else that's more important coming down the pipe versus something else in the city that may be able to be put off or not purchased at all. That's my issue. That's why I want to know about. That's why I'm saying let's meet weekly. Let's give me that 5 minutes. Tell me what I need. I mean, I see Brad once a month. I've met with Noel, I've met with Rodney. But I there's no reason they can't be here the first 5-10 minutes of every one of our meetings.
Sure there is.
And well, you don't have to be here, Rodney. Dr. King.
Well, Sam, I think
but I want to know.
We'll let Sam and Marcus come up with it. They'll on the 10th.
Don't you have education?
Okay. You're going to have to look at your the agenda here and decide what you're going to drop out.
Sure.
Okay. All right. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.